So recently I heard of an older guy that we would call him like a senior saint, who was quite lonely, so he decided to go to the pet store and find some kind of companion. When he got there, they ran out of dogs, he really didn't consider cats. He looked up, and the guy had a parrot, a huge parrot. And so he said to the guy how much, and it was pretty low cost, much cheaper than he thought, so he bought the parrot. Took it home thinking, I'll have a buddy and I'll teach it to talk. So he gets the parrot home, and the problem is the parrot already knew how to talk, but there was a problem with this parrot because it cussed like a drunk sailor. So here this guy is trying to have some, you know, some fellowship and some companion, but this parrot just kept swearing and swearing and swearing. He didn't know what to do about it. So he called the pet store, and the pet store said, no, we don't want the bird back. The bird swears. He said, why didn't you tell me? He said, because you wouldn't take it. So he's telling his sister about this, and his sister says, you know what, I know a lady with a parrot, and the parrot is very spiritual. And in fact, the parrot just sits on its perch all day long and just says, let's pray, let's pray. So, true story, Holly. Okay. So, you know, she said, well, I'll see if I can get your spiritual parrot together with this guy's parrot that just cusses like a drunk sailor. And so they kind of lined up a meeting, and she brought the parrot over to the guy's house. And upon entering the room with this, her spiritual parrot, let's pray, let us pray, let us pray. She brought in the room, no big surprises. This guy's parrot bellows out, hello, Hots! To which the spiritual parrot said, my prayers have been answered. I promise. But I got no way to segue that into a message today. Grab your Bible, turn with me to the book of Galatians. I kept thinking the other day, okay, if that's so funny, I thought it was. How do you segue that into this? I got nothing right now. Okay. So we are in a study of the book of Galatians, and the theme to the book of Galatians is very clearly this. Jesus sets us free. Jesus has done for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Let me give you some background. Paul traveled the known world, and the Apostle Paul traveled the known world spreading that message. Jesus Christ sets us free. But just after Paul would leave a church that he began with this powerful message of the resurrection and Christ sets us free, a group of Christian Jews would come in behind him, and in a sense, they would pull the rug out from underneath Paul and his truth, and they would begin to teach a lie, and their lie was this, no, works make us free. So Paul wrote this letter to Galatians to battle against this false teaching. And it was a battle, by the way, that Paul fought his entire ministry. You see, the followers of Jesus were also Jewish. And as such, they were raised and they were inundated with Jewish law, rules and regulations and social norms that they were taught that they had to live to have favor with God. And they kept, like institutions will do, they kept adding to them and building them up through the centuries. So by the time Jesus hits the scene, there's 600 plus laws that Jewish leaders are telling Jewish people they have to keep in order to make God happy. Okay. Then Jesus comes on the scene, God in the flesh, God breaks into time. He breaks the time, he shouts at the world in the person of Jesus Christ, and he comes in and says, no, really, there's two worlds. I'm going to sum the law up in two ways to live. Love God with all of your heart, your soul, your strength, and go love your neighbor like you love yourself. There's a new law, Jesus said. Love God and love people. And this was extremely freeing to people who put their faith in Jesus Christ. People who learned that the law really was such that we couldn't ever measure up. By the way, God said, let me tell you why I gave you the law. I didn't give the law to train you how to live or to try to legislate morality. I gave you the law to show you The law just revealed your sin. And until you understand your sin, you won't understand your need for repentance. And then Jesus said, okay, now you got it. Now go love God. And go love people. And to those who followed Jesus, this was really good news. But then these early followers of Jesus who were Jewish came along, and they heard the good news and accepted it. And then they watched. Listen, wait a minute here. Non-Jews, Gentiles, are accepting that good news also. And these non-Jews, Gentiles, as they were called, didn't grow up with the Old Testament. They didn't grow up with the laws. And when they became followers of Jesus, this created incredible tension within the church. Because you have these Jewish Christians saying, you know, follow Jesus, but by the way, don't abandon the law. I think we still need it. We may not, but it's a safety net just in case. So keep doing good works to get favor with God. And then these Gentile believers just accepted the good news of Jesus Christ. He died for my sin. He rose from the grave and proved he was God. He forgives me and I'm set free. So these two groups came together. And then the church caused a lot of friction in the early church. These Jewish followers didn't handle it well. They said, you know what? They don't act like us. They don't think like us. These Gentiles don't dress like us. They certainly don't eat like us. And some of these Jewish Christians began to say, well, I think they should. And at the same time, you have the apostles going through the normal proclaiming, Jew, non-Jew, Greek, Roman, it doesn't matter. Jesus sets us free. So picture this tension. One side, people digging in their heels. Salvation is in Christ, but only if you do good works. And we'll tell you what the works are. And the other side, people passionately proclaiming the salvation is through Jesus Christ alone. And Jesus plus nothing equals everything. So you know where this ended? You know where this ended up at? Go figure. Somebody called a meeting. They called a church meeting. Okay? And the church meeting took place in Jerusalem. And Paul and Barnabas traveled to Jerusalem. And they took their young friend Titus with them, because Titus was a Gentile. And Titus was a living example that God could change and save a non-Jew. So the church fathers got together, the apostles were there, and they called this meeting, and they came to an extremely important decision that has impacted your life even today. And here was the decision. You don't have to convert to Judaism to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Salvation is through faith alone. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Try to get your minds around this. So there was a huddle-up of the early Christians in the first century who came together and made a decision that was so powerful, 21 centuries later, you're the result of that in Christ Jesus. So with that background, grab your Bibles and turn with me to the second chapter of Galatians. I'm going to show you how the Apostle Paul addresses this, what Paul says about it, and then we're going to talk about what it means in our lives today and our faith and followership of Jesus today. Okay. So if you go to Galatians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, you're going to see here that Paul reminds the church of Galatia, this whole region that is Turkey today, he's going to remind them, okay, that salvation is through Christ alone. That battle, that issue, that major topic has been settled. Okay? Galatians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. He says, this matter arose because some false teachers, okay, those Jewish Christians, had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. Look at verse 5. We did not give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. So here's what Paul's saying. Paul is saying, salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ alone, not by works. Don't budge on this truth. We fought the battle. We know this is God's will. Don't budge. Don't back off. Don't throw up the white flag. Don't surrender to the teaching. Now, Paul was concerned because he had seen people struggle with this issue. And guys, isn't it true that when we learn that salvation is through faith in Christ alone, okay, not by our works, okay, isn't it true that bugs us just a little bit? Because we want to do something to add to it. Yeah, I know Jesus, you got me 90% of the way, but let me help. I know Jesus, that it's all done on the cross, and you paid the price for my sin, and it's all forgiven, and all I have to do is receive it. But can it really be that easy, Jesus? Come on. Let me create my list of things I ought to do, and if I do the list, then we're good. Right? And Jesus said, no. Not at all. Paul said, no. In fact, not only did we struggle with it, there were others who struggled with it. Go down to verses 11 to 13, because Paul talks about that. In Galatians 2, verse 11, he describes this moment. He says, when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. So Cephas is another name for Peter. So this is the Apostle Peter. Okay? And it's hard to get our minds around two stronger personalities than Peter and the Apostle Paul. So Peter comes into Antioch. Paul learns that Peter, you've been playing both sides of the fence here. When you're in front of Jewish people, your Jewish kindred, you say, yeah, salvation is through faith, but we got to keep the law. Yeah, I don't know what we're going to do with those Gentiles. They're just living so free. They're eating anything they want. And then, when he's with the Gentiles, he's saying, yeah, but you guys are awesome. Salvation is through faith in Christ alone. Yeah, you're under grace. I don't know about those Jews. They're still locked up in the law. He's playing both sides of the fence. So, when he comes to Antioch, Paul opposes him. Paul takes him on because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. There we go. When they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group, that is, the Jews. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas loved Scripture. So Barnabas was a convert of Paul. He was probably a young believer at this point. He was very impressionable. So by the way, heads up on this one. Be aware of your witness, especially in front of young believers. Because they're watching you to see how the gospel is working in your life. Be cognizant of that. Peter wasn't. He played both sides of the fence in this issue, and so even Barnabas was led astray. So Paul seen how dangerous this is, and probably because of Peter's actions, and they were done in public, so he deals with it in public. Go to Galatians 2:16. Okay? Here's how Paul capsulizes all this. He says, knowing that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Jesus that we may be justified by what? Church, what?
Faith.
Guys, that is a mega bomb, powerful statement. It's a statement that is so powerful. It changed the early church. It launched the church into reaching the entire known world within two generations. It changed the known world of that time. Ratchet up to about the mid-1500s, okay? A guy by the name of Martin Luther took that truth right there, nailed it to a Wittenberg door, a door in Germany, at a church, okay, wrapped up in rules, and birthed a movement called the Reformation, which is why you're here this morning. Paul says, we're justified by faith and not by works of law, because by the works of law, no one will be what? Justified. The word literally means right with God. In other words, Paul is saying, look, the law came. not to get you to work harder to be better. And that God is this mean teacher that every time you get to hear, he goes to hear. The law came to show you your foolishness. That God is so high and holy and perfect. You can never do it on your own strength. What makes us right with God is faith in Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross. So let's bring it home to how we live today, and two or three truths we can just get our mind around. The first truth is this, okay? And this is a major truth in the body of Christ, okay? The cross, follow me on this one, the cross was not a team effort. Somebody say amen. The cross was not a team effort. Now, in Michigan, it's almost like a rite of passage to go to Mackinac Island. Okay, how many have ever been to Mackinac Island? Okay, very cool. Okay. And I don't like people, for us, as you know, coming from Indiana to Michigan, it became kind of a rite of passage to get to the island with our daughters and to bike around the island. Okay, how many have ever done that? Yeah, so we did that, took the boat over. Holly and Kristen were very young, third, fourth, fifth grade, kind of thing. And we got there, we wanted to bike around the island, and so we said, how are we going to do this? They were pretty young, so Captain and I said, let's do tandem bikes. Okay? Let's do tandem bikes. True story. We got on the far side of the island, and it poured down rain on us. Okay? So I remember getting on the tandem bike, putting Holly here, helmet on, hang on tight, honey, here we go. We take off around the island, okay? I didn't think we were going to make it, okay? Because, you know, if you're on the back of these things and you shift your weight or you decide to reach out and grab a limb that's close by, how many of you know what I'm talking about? Huh? And here's what was amazingly funny about it, is I look back now at it, which was just a wonderful memory for me. I look back now, and we didn't get very far, okay, that Holly realized she'd have to pedal. And I remember looking up, and she literally had her legs crossed on the end of her. And she's like, go, Dad, go. And I'm looking back, I remember saying, Holly, tandem, it's a team sport. It's a team effort. You got to pedal, honey. No, I don't, Dad. You're doing it all. So the purpose of a tandem is very simple. Both people pedal to get you where you need to go. Correct? Okay. Then when Hannah came along, these things came out. Okay. Now the premise with the bike and trailer is really simple. You get your kid in it, you give them a helmet, you strap them down, and they do nothing. They're simply along for the ride. Correct? Guys, it amazed me when we had one of these with Hannah, and I put her in it, and I would bike with her. And when I get done biking, and I get her out, she act like she's exhausted. She's, oh my God. But you get in, you sit tight, and all of the power is up here. Correct? Mm-hmm. Okay, follow me on this. What Paul is saying is this. Our salvation is not a tandem ride. For God put you in the back seat and said, I'll supply some of the power, but you sure had better pedal if you're going to follow me. Not a tandem ride. Cross was not a team effort. Our salvation is a bike with a trailer. And Jesus said, get in. I'll carry you. I'll take you where you need to go. And I'll never go. Now you can argue this point and say, man, didn't we do anything in salvation? I can say, well, yeah, I guess you can argue the point and say, yeah. The one thing you did is you brought your sin to the table. And Jesus said, it's forgiven. But in that moment and after that moment, our salvation, what Jesus did on the cross, not a tandem. team effort. Our salvation was God doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. He simply says, give in and trust me. Trust me. I'll get you where you need to go. I'll help you get there on my power and on my strength. Okay. Now, illustrations are fun and cool and hopefully they help. As I played this one through my mind, I thought to myself, maybe one of us went with this one. Whatever different direction. So you got the whole thing. The cross was not a team effort. It was all God in Christ Jesus reconciling the world to himself in you and me. Okay. But I guess there's a sense in which we get on the tandem with God, and God leads in God's power and God's strength. But God does invite us to follow him under the flow and direction and power of his Holy Spirit. So, whatever illustration you use here, how do we pick this up? Remember this, guys. Our salvation is not a result of our effort. Our salvation is a result of what God did for us. Period. The old song says it so well. We used to sing it as a kid. The song that Jesus paid it all. They part of it. Paid it all. Tim Keller says it this way. Christ will do everything for you, or he'll do nothing. And guys, this is powerful in our body of Christ as a fellowship. It's powerfully important, it's critical, because we want to be a church of the Word of God that has integrity, rightly dividing the Word of God. We don't want to add to it a bunch of man-made rules so that people come in and they say, wait a minute here, here's a group of Christians meeting, but they look so depressed. I go to work and experience that. What they should do is come into this fellowship of believers, wherever we're at. And the message we send is this: Jesus Christ can set you free, period. And Jesus did it all on the cross. Just receive it. Let me give you a second truth as I try to bring this to our, right to where we live, okay? Forgetting this truth, forgetting what God did for us, can lead to a judgmental attitude and self-righteousness. And if the Apostle Peter and Barnabas can forget, and they need reminded, we might need reminded too. Because here's what happens. If we believe that our salvation is a tandem ride, and God's doing 90%, but I better head on back here, and I better pedal hard too and work hard to be better to keep my salvation. If we believe that, it'll do two things. We believe that it'll either drive us to depression. The Christian life doesn't work. I'm up, but I'm down. I'm up, but I'm down. When I'm really doing well and I'm saying no to temptation, then God loves me, and dude, I'm scoring an A. You know, when I go to Tom's class or not, I got an A. But when I'm not doing so well and I'm crashing, God doesn't love me anymore. And so you're up and down. It'll lead to that depression. Or the other thing it'll do, okay, because we're so able to fool ourselves, we'll get a pumped up view of ourselves that becomes self-righteousness. Well, God, I'm so cool and I'm so committed and I'm so godly, God only has to pedal about half the time. Because I'm taking this baby home all the way to heaven. Believe me, won't you? So we need to come together as a body of believers on a regular basis, guys. In small groups, in study groups, in fellowship, in prayer meetings. Together serving God, doing ministry, being in the service, and worshiping together. Because when we do that and we're with other believers, it realigns us. When we begin to live this healthy life of repentance and humility before God, we're reminded again, we're just riding in the backseat, guys. Jesus did it all on the cross. One more truth. When we're realigned, with God through good works. Okay? It brings a joy and a freedom to our life that the world will find attractive. And in that freedom, and in that joy, track me on this one, we begin to follow God, okay? And serve God, and do good works for God, not because we're in the back seat and we got to pedal hard, but because we love God. In fact, let me show you something. You got your Bibles, right? Let me show you something. I was in time studying the Word, and this is now some quiet time I was spending with God. And after I wrote last week's sermon, a passage back from chapter 1 jumped out at me. I want to read it to you because it's a wonderful testimony about how Paul lived his life when he understood this truth. You got your Bibles and you grab your Bibles. Go over to Galatians 1 and go down to verse 23. So Galatians 1, 23. And the Apostle Paul, again, now remember, this is a personal letter to Christians in the area of Turkey, Galatians. Paul had no idea that 2,000 years later, Dave Coleman was going to be reading this to you. Okay. This is a very transparent, very authentic moment with Paul. And he says this, "Then I went to Syria and Cilicia. I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ." So I went to Sicily, I went to Cilicia. He said this, "They didn't know me personally." But look what he said, verse 23. "They only heard the report." What do you mean the report? Well, the rumor mill had cranked it out. People were talking in the early church, and they heard about this guy by the name of Saul, who was a Jewish leader who decided and got permission to go through the Mediterranean to find Christians and either kill them or enslave them. And that's what he was doing. And then they found out that Jesus met him face to face, changed him, transformed him. And now he's going around the Mediterranean and he's starting churches. That's what they heard. And Paul said this, "The man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy." And look what he says in verse 24. "And they praise God because of me." Don't let that phrase leave your mind quickly. Paul is saying this. "I came to know Jesus Christ, and he changed my life. And I served God with a passion. Christ is in the center. And I did what you and I would call today." Paul would say, "Yeah, I did a ton of good works. You know, I found people, I witnessed, I shared, I served, I ministered, I cared for, I preached." But Paul says the purpose of the reason I did this was not to earn my salvation. The reason I did this was that through my life, God is the glory. God gets the glory. This is something great for God. And somebody says, "Man, way to go. Good job." Just take that praise, turn right around, and lay it at the foot of the cross. Say, "Jesus, if that had been for you, I would never have done that." People say, "Dave, great job. Thank you so much. That is so encouraging." In your heart, off your lips is, "Let God be glorified." It's all about Jesus. Yeah, a crazy thought this week. I don't bounce my jokes off other people because they won't want to tell them. But I crazy thoughts I bounce off people. Okay, so I had a crazy thought this week. I thought to myself, okay, so we're a church. How many believe what I just preached for 30 minutes? How many? Please raise your hands. Please. Okay. So we need to be a church that does good things. Not to earn our salvation, pump ourselves up, but that through our lives, the way we live, people see us and they say, "God must be alive. Jesus Christ must be real." So I thought, how do we apply this? So, believe it or not, Thanksgiving's around the corner. I thought, what if we do this? What if we gather up a bunch of turkeys, frozen turkeys, I don't know, let's say 30, I don't know, whatever, and we put together a box, and we fill it with everything that a family needs for Thanksgiving dinner. There are families in this area that will think about Thanksgiving, and a nice Thanksgiving dinner will be tough to do. So what if we put together Thanksgiving dinner for family, and then the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we put it all together. So you come in that Sunday morning, the foyer's got an area that's just packed full of turkeys and food that you brought in. Okay. And then after church, we pack it up. So quick assembly line, everybody gets potatoes, everybody gets yams, if you like yams, I was like, you know, everybody gets dressing, everybody gets a turkey. And then we have a team that has found places in the area that we could take 10 turkeys to, 10 meals to, and that place will distribute them to people. We'll get the word out. If you need one, come and get it. And in the name of Jesus Christ, we just get turkeys and Thanksgiving dinner out to our family. Wouldn't that be cool? So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray, and if you think you would like to be a part of administrating that, we're going to put it together, okay? That's awesome. We're going to be right over here after service, and I'll just send around a sign-up list. You can sign it, and we'll contact you this week. If you say, man, my world doesn't allow me to be a part of administrating that, organizing that, but it doesn't. That's okay. Hang in there, because there'll be things you can do, like sponsor a turkey, sponsor a dinner, bring some food, so everybody can be involved. Okay, so I'm going to say a prayer, and the guys are going to come up. Hey, by the way, did you guys notice that when you came in this morning, rather than the Spotify background music, we had some live music up there with the guitar. Isn't that pretty cool, guys? So the guys are going to come up. They're going to kind of set the tone, and I'll pray, and then if you'd like to be a part of helping organize and laying this out, help us find people who will get it to people, that'd be awesome. We'll meet right over here on the right for just a second. I'll keep you just a second. Let us bow down. Oh, Father, thank you for God, thank you for Jesus and what he did for us on the cross. Lord, forgive us for times that we have thought, lived, acted like our self-righteousness gets us to heaven. The cross was enough. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you, God, for a slate wiped clean. Thank you for giving us new life and loving us. Thank you, Lord, for making heaven our eternal home. Get over.